Today, I'm going to talk about the last unexplored part of electromagnetic spectrum. Okay. So this is electromagnetic spectrum. On the left, we have lower frequencies corresponding to higher wavelength. And as you move from left to right, you have higher frequencies and hence lower wavelength. Different parts of EM spectrum interact differently with matter. And as a result, we divide the spectrum into different sections, like RF, visible light, ultraviolet, X-ray, and so on. Developing a technology to generate, detect, and process signals at any part of this spectrum has profoundly changed our daily life. Let me give you the first example, which is visible light, from 780 nanometer to 380 nanometer on the wavelength. Now, making light bulb has changed our life. But the key here is having a technology, like in the case of light bulb, which is low cost and accessible. Just imagine if the light bulb was $10,000, it would not have had the same impact that it has today. Let's look at another, one of my favorite examples, which is RF technology. I think RF has really changed the way that we communicate as human beings. You know, it has made us closer together and enables us to share, you know, ideas, hopes, and fears, regardless of our physical location on planet, or maybe off the planet. But again, here, the key is that we have a technology which is low cost and accessible. Now, let me introduce the last unexplored wavelength frontier, which is terahertz. Terahertz is officially defined between 300 gigahertz and 3 terahertz, which would translate into wavelength of 1 millimeter to 100 micrometer, or 0.1 millimeter. This part of EM spectrum is not different than any other. And potentially, it could basically change our life. Unfortunately, or maybe fortunately for us, there is no low-cost accessible technology to address this part of the spectrum. And I'm going to explain why. But before I do that, I want to talk about the application of terahertz. Before I go through the list of different applications, which are really cool, let me mention that some of the success stories that we have had in the past with RF, optics, X-ray, microwave, and so on, a lot of really cool applications came after we had the technology. So same way with terahertz, we now have a list of really intriguing applications. But maybe the killer application is out there to be discovered after we develop the technology. OK, so terahertz is actually scientifically very interesting. The science objectives include examining molecular clouds and dark cloud cores to basically understand the galaxy formation and evolution, and basically learn about the history of our universe. Now, terahertz basically corresponds to very small wavelengths, less than 1 millimeter, which would translate into high-resolution imaging. We could also add spectral identification with imaging in order to look for certain material while we do imaging. These two images are basically taken in collaboration with Professor Ken O's group in UT Dallas. The lower one, we have an image of a wallet. Inside there is a coin and a blade. This is taken at 260 gigahertz. On top, we have a floppy disk, which we don't see very often these days. The left one is at 280 gigahertz, and the right one is at 860. So at 860, because the wavelength is smaller, you can see a lot of details in here. So the resolution is fantastic. It's basically better than 1 millimeter resolution. For a lot of imaging applications, if you look at a state-of-the-art detectors, which we also work on, I'm not going to talk about detectors today, in order to have these kind of images, we need around 1 milliwatt of power at the source side. So 1 milliwatt for a lot of applications is basically the magic number. And we are basically after finding a technology that could generate 1 milliwatt in a very low-cost way. Another application space, which is really interesting, is actually medical imaging. Water absorption, I mean, in terahertz band is very high. So wherever you're looking for water, terahertz signal is really good. So basically, hydration sensing. The first example is corneal hydration sensing, which is essential for procedures like LASIK or for detection of glaucoma. Another application is to basically determine the level of burns on somebody's skin, or actually looking for a skin cancer. Okay? Another application is on the medical side of things, is basically to look for tooth decay and look for cavities. One of my favorite examples, which is at a very early stage, but I think it's very promising, is actually measuring somebody's blood glucose based on their exhale. So we have a small device, and this is our vision, and you put basically in front of your mouth, and then you just breathe through it, and then it basically measures your blood glucose. And last but not least is basically communication. Because the frequency is high, potentially offers very wide bandwidth. And just imagine that your cell phone could communicate at 100 gigabit per second or 40 gigabit per second data rate. The opportunities would be basically endless. This is going to be over short distance, maybe 1 to 10 meter, but the data rate is going to be very high. So you could basically download the whole high definition movie in a matter of seconds. OK, so the applications are there. How about solutions? If you look right now, the solutions that we have are the ones on the left, which are really bulky and expensive. This is kind of like your $10,000 light bulb, which is not going to change the daily life. Instead, what we really want is something which is portable and low cost, like the ones on the right. And the moment that I say portable and low cost, it automatically translates into integrated circuits. Okay? So what we really want is a low-cost integrated solution, which is obviously very portable. Now, the challenge is actually, unfortunately, this famous plot, which is known as Terahertz Gap. On the x-axis, we have frequency, and y-axis is basically the amount of power that we can generate using different technologies. It's noteworthy that almost all the dots here, or different shapes that we have on this plot, are not low-cost. So even if you forget about cost, the power that we can generate is actually very low. And the reason is that actually terahertz is in a very strange position. It's between modern electronics and modern optics. So it's kind of like falling through the cracks. So the frequency is too high for electronics, as you can see on the stuff on the left of the plot. These are all electronic sources. So for electronics, it's really hard to go to higher frequency. But for optics, it's really hard to come to lower frequency. And hence, we have this gap which falls exactly on terahertz. What we really want is to basically fill this gap in between and basically introduce a low-cost accessible technology for terahertz. Now, the question is that what kind of integrated solution we want to have. In order to address that, let me just ask you a simple question. Which one of these two is more powerful? You know, the giant spider or a tiny ant? I don't know if you can see the ant, but there is a really tiny, teeny tiny ant in there. So obviously, the spider is more powerful. But the power that ant has is basically we could have a large colony of ants. And when you have a large colony of ants, they could basically collaborate. And then you basically compare the collaborative power of ants with a giant spider. And I think a colony of ants could take down any spider, or maybe even larger animals. Right? The other thing is that it's not just about working together, but if you have a colony of ants, it's actually very flexible. Because each one of them at different times could do different tasks. So it's not just like one giant spider. It's very flexible. And most importantly, you know, ants are almost free. You know, for every human being, there are around 1 million ants worldwide. So you could basically use ants instead of that spider. In terms of technology, this is what we have. We have really big spiders. These are compound semiconductors. Compound semiconductors like indium phosphide HBT or gallium nitride hemmed devices, these are devices that could handle high frequency and high power. But this is based exactly like that $10,000 light bulb. These are expensive material, and it's very hard to design a system on a chip with a lot of flexibility, a lot of signal processing capabilities, and so on. On the other hand, CMOS is that tiny ant. It has a lot of capability. It's almost free. It's actually next to nothing. But it cannot handle high power. It cannot go to high frequencies. The problem of high power is easy to solve because ants are free, CMOS is free. We could basically have thousands of and millions of, you know, billions of CMOS transistors working together. And collectively, they would generate more power than any compound semiconductor. The problem is actually frequency. They are not really fast. So let me just remind you that transistors have this critical number, which is the maximum frequency that they could operate. Beyond that frequency, they turn into passive devices, then they're useless. So what we really want, because we want to develop accessible, low-cost technology, and that's the name of the game, what we really want is to basically push CMOS into terahertz frequency range. How do we do that? And that's a really challenging problem. We thought about it, and we said, OK, you know, terahertz is like wave. And we have waves in other disciplines. And there is a very rich body of knowledge on the theory of wave propagation. There are different phenomena that we could take advantage of. And we looked basically for a large class of different concepts that we could introduce to CMOS in order to enable it to operate at higher frequency. I'll give you two quick examples very quickly without going too deep into them. The first one is actually a parametric process. So parametric process is, in order to understand it, let's just imagine that you are on a swing and you don't have anybody to push you, so you have to do the hard job yourself by sitting down and standing up. If you have this scenario, what you want to do is that at the peaks you want to stand up, at the zero crossing you want to sit down. Okay? That way, by moving your center of mass, you pump energy into a swing. And the idea is that you basically have another signal at a different frequency, in this case twice the frequency of your swing, because at every turn of swing you have to sit down and stand up twice. You use another signal to amplify something else. Now, we can't do that with integrated circuits. Again, this is an old concept that we have used on CMOS. Imagine that you have an inductor and capacitor, and you have some resonance. And at the resonance frequency, you have some signal. What I'm going to do is to modulate the capacitor plates in a certain way. When the voltage is maximum, I'm going to pull the capacitor plates apart from each other. That would basically decrease the capacitance. And conservation of charge tells me that the voltage needs to go up. So at the peak, I will get basically a tiny increase in voltage. At the zero crossing, what I'm going to do is to basically return the capacitor plates to the original place. The voltage is zero, hence it doesn't change. The idea here is that I get amplification without any transistor. So I basically get amplification through some nonlinearity in the system. So this is one idea in order to be able to operate beyond the limits of transistor. Let me give you another example, which is, I mean, the basic idea is very simple, and that's Doppler shift. We all know that when the transmitter and receiver move toward each other, what happens is that receiver receives a signal which is higher than the signal that transmitter sends. That's a very well-known effect. What we did, we actually designed a circuit which exactly does that. So I basically have two signals that are moving in opposite direction. One of them samples the other one. And by sample, what I mean is that they basically turn on and off these switches, which are really the transistors. So the key here is that only the red part is at high frequency, but the black is at much lower frequency. So the transistor thinks that it operates at this input frequency, which is much lower. So you could basically have a transistor which switches at lower frequency, but it generates something at higher frequency. Of course, this was the simple idea, which was developed by one of my students. In reality, what we do is that we basically put this in a much more complicated structure. It's basically in a ring, and then basically we form standing waves, and so on and so forth. And then we have coupled oscillators in certain ways. But the basic idea is very simple. It comes from basically Doppler shift. So we put everything together. I'm going to show you a gallery of different things that we have done on CMOS. Everything that I show here is basically low-cost CMOS. It's the same process that we have on microprocessors in your computer. So it's nothing fancy. This is exactly that $1 light bulb. The first thing that we did 2 years ago is an oscillator. It's a source at 480 gigahertz, which generates 0.16 milliwatt of power. You know, in order to appreciate this, at the time, this was actually 10,000 times more than the state of the art on CMOS. So with a simple trick, we were able to push CMOS into a domain that was not known in the past. After that, we did a broadband source at 244, which generated 0.25 milliwatts. So things started to become more and more interesting. Then we did a source which was very broadband at 480 with 0.25 milliwatt of power. Again, on a standard CMOS. And if you look at the scale, these things are really, really tiny. And the last one was a 320 gigahertz source, which was also tunable, and generated 0.75 milliwatts. So we actually got very close to the 1 milliwatt number, which was the magic number for us. And then this year, we actually did this array. Again, remember, this is basically ants, so we could basically make a colony of them. And this is a very small colony of ants. So we have 8 sources. What you see here are basically antennas. These are slot antennas on the CMOS chip. So we have sources here, and then there are a lot of nonlinear couplings between them, and these things are basically the antennas which would radiate off of the plane. One thing to mention for terahertz, actually making antennas is very easy because the wavelength is small. We could basically package everything in a very simple way. So it's much easier than RF or millimeter wave or basically microwave. So this thing can basically generate more than a milliwatt of real power. It's actually 1.1 milliwatt of power. But because it's an array, the effective power that it radiates is actually 40 milliwatt, which is more than what we need for a lot of these applications. And this is basically a prototype, which is, was assembled by one of my students. So you can see it's actually really, really cheap, really, really cheap. And at the core of it, we have a CMOS chip, which is 1.5 millimeter on the side. And if you basically mass produce this, it's gonna, you're basically talking about a couple of dollars, right? But this thing actually has a lot of digital signal capability, signal processing capability inside. It's a complete transmitter for a spectroscopy, and we could do basically a lot of interesting stuff with this guy at terahertz range. So this basically shows the comparison. This is sort of a slide that I would show when I go to DARPA for meetings. So here you could see basically other works on CMOS and indium phosphide and silicon germanium. The red ones are the ones that we have done with standard CMOS. And my favorite point is the one on the top right, where we actually have indium phosphide, which is the best semiconductor, compound semiconductor for this frequency range. And as you can see, our CMOS solution actually beats that one by 2 dB. It's almost a factor of 2. I mean, 3 dB is twice as much power. And this is actually exactly that colony of ants beating that giant spider. Right? And the ones that we are working on right now is actually off the chart, again, on standard CMOS. And that's really, really exciting. So the message here is that we actually are squeezing the last drop of blood out of CMOS in order to push CMOS to go to terahertz. And when that happens, I think the opportunities are endless. We basically have discovered a new wavelength frontier, and there are a lot of things that we could explore since we have this very low-cost technology. In the end, I would really like to thank all my students. These are the people who actually make it happen, and obviously all the funding agencies that fund my research. Thank you very much.